नमस्ते एवरीवन, दिस इज डॉक्टर प्रतिभा केस, हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ बायोटेक्नोलॉजी एट केली सोसाइटीज एस निजलिंगप्पा कॉलेज, राजेनगर, बेंगलुरु. टुडे आई एम बिफोर यू टू प्रेजेंट अ क्वेश्चन एंड आंसर्स रिलेटेड टू प्रोटीन्स. व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट लेवल्स ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ऑफ स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ अ प्रोटीन? आर्ग्यू द स्ट्रक्चरल हायरार्की ऑफ द प्रोटीन्स. आंसर: प्राइमरी स्ट्रक्चर, सेकेंडरी स्ट्रक्चर, टर्शियरी स्ट्रक्चर, क्वार्टरनरी structure. Huh? You may also asked give the structural hierarchy of the proteins. That time you must give that particular answer. Second question: what are the main features of primary structure of a protein? Primary structure comprises the sequence or order of amino acids in the polypeptide chains, and location of disulfide bonds in them can be observed in the insulin or particular structure representation. Okay, peptide bond is the main force which maintains primary structure, right? The primary, this particular primary structure, you can see the presence of the peptide bond, which is formed between the carboxyl group of one amino acid and amino group of the another amino acid. Through the condensation process, you can see the formation of the peptide bond. So the amino acids which are joined together through the peptide bond, right? The polypeptide chain has one N terminal amino acid, right? One N terminal amino acid. That is first amino acid on left terminal of polypeptide chain having free amino group. Okay, when you take DNA molecule, how you'll get one end as 5' phosphate and another end as 3' hydroxyl? No, like that in polypeptide chain protein molecule, you'll get one end as N terminal amino acid. Okay, and another one C terminal amino acid, that is last amino acid having free carboxyl group. In between the amino acids, in between these two amino acids, are what are the amino acids will be there in the polypeptide chain or the protein molecules? We can two amino acids, all the amino acids which are joined together by the peptide bond. Okay, so you can see the amino group will be there and carboxyl will be there. Then you will be able to see C terminal amino acid. Then here you can also see N terminal amino acid. The next question: what are the main features of structure of insulin? Insulin, answer: insulin is a protein hormone secreted by the beta cells of islets of Langerhans. Insulin consists of two polypeptide chains, in which one chain known as A chain and other chain known as B chain. Okay, and composed of 51 amino acids. Total 51 amino acids will be there. Their molecular weight is 5,734 daltons. We have two chains, one is A chain, other one is the B chain. In A chain, you can see the total amino acids 21 and B chain 30 amino acids. So together total 51 amino acids. Okay, and usually you'll get in the polypeptide chain in insulin N terminal amino acid, that is glycine. Okay, in this A chain, and in the A chain the C terminal amino acid is aspergine, whereas in the B chain N terminal region you can see phenylalanine, and C terminal region you can see the presence of threonine amino acid. Okay, so this is structure representation of the insulin polypeptide chain. Two chains are joined by two interdisulfide bonds. What are the two? A chain and B chain are there? No, those are held together by two inter means between the two polypeptide chain. Okay, in first bond is formed by seventh cysteine of A chain and seventh cysteine of B chain. Okay, we can see the formation of interdisulfide bond. Second bond is formed by 20th cysteine of A chain and 19th cysteine of B chain. Okay, one intradisulfide bond is present in the A chain and formed by 6th cysteine to 11th cysteine. Okay, this is about the structural representation of the insulin molecule. Okay, two chains are joined by two interdisulfide bonds. Okay, and again you can see one intradisulfide bond in the A chain formed by 6th cysteine to 11th cysteine. Okay, let us see the structural representation here. Okay, this is the A chain and this is the B chain. Okay, you can see the presence of two interdisulfide bond. Inter means two, between the two polypeptide chain. okay, and this is intradisulfide bond, okay, which is formed in between the two, in the same polypeptide chain we can see the disulfide bond formation. So this is about the insulin structural representation. Okay, what is secondary structure of a protein, and give examples. Okay, I'm just giving a brief information here. If you want, you can also refer in details my other videos of protein. Okay, the regular folding and twisting of the polypeptide chain brought about by hydrogen bonds is called secondary structure of proteins. It means secondary structure of structure of the proteins are stabilized by the hydrogen bonds. Their native configuration was possible only because of the hydrogen bonds. For example, what are the secondary structure? Alpha helix, okay, and another one is beta pleated sheets. So where all you can see the alpha helix structure representation? In the fibrous proteins and in the globular protein. Fibrous proteins like keratin of hair, nails and skin, then myosin and tropomyosin of muscles. Globular proteins, that is in the hemoglobin, okay, and beta pleated sheets in silk fibrin, you can see the presence of secondary structure of the proteins. Okay, now let us go through brief salient features of the alpha helix. Okay, the distance traveled per turn of helix is 0.54 nm, and you can see in each turn 3.6 amino acid residues which take part. You can see here, right, distance per turn of the helix 3.6 amino acid residues. The distance between the adjacent amino acid residues are 0.15 nm. Proline and hydroxyproline disrupt helix. Okay, hydrogen bonds and van der Waals forces stabilize this alpha helix structure. This is the central axis, the alpha helix that will be around to this particular central axis. Now let us go through salient features of beta pleated sheets. It is a sheet rather than rod. Okay, the distance between the adjacent amino acid is 3.5 angstrom, and sheets are composed of two or more than two polypeptide chains, and also we can see anti-parallel sheets. Okay, and also in opposite directions. The alignment of polypeptide chains in beta pleated sheet is parallel pleated sheet. Okay, we can also see anti-parallel pleated sheets. Peptide chains are side by side and lie in the same direction. Okay, so that is about the secondary structure, alpha helix and beta pleated sheets. If you want more information, kindly refer my protein video. Okay, so what are the salient features of triple helix structure of collagen? Answer: collagen consists of approximately 1000 amino acids. The repeating unit of collagen structure is represented by glycine XYNN. About 100 of X positions are prolines, and 100 of Y positions are hydroxyprolines. Due to presence of proline, hydroxyproline and glycine in the structure of collagen, these amino acids prevent alpha helix and beta pleated structure and forms triple helix structure. Okay, collagen is composed of three polypeptide chains, as the name suggests, triple helix. Three polypeptide chain, they are held together in a very tight wrapping condition, okay, to give triple helix. Each alpha chain is twisted into left-handed helix of three residues per turn. Three alpha chains, okay, then form a rod-like structure, and that will be very rigid. And here, most you can see simple amino acids in the triple helix and responsible for the tight binding of the polypeptide chain. Forces of a triple helix, that is hydrogen bonds. Left-handed helices are held together by interchain hydrogen bonds. Okay, then lysine or leucine bond can be absorbed. And also we can see in the triple helix, covalent crosslinks. Collagen fibers are further stabilized by the formation of covalent crosslinks both within and between triple helical units. This occurs by lysyl oxidase, which causes oxidative deamination of the NH2 amino group of lysine and hydroxyl lysine residues to form aldehydes. Okay, so here you can see the triple helix structure of collagen, where you can see the presence of three polypeptide chain which coiled very tightly. Okay, in detail, if you want, you can see in my proteins video or to get more information. Okay, covalent crosslinks, I've already told you about that one, that covalent crosslinks actually responsible for the tight coiling of this particular triple helix can nature. Next question, what are the salient features of tertiary structure of a protein? The looping and winding of the secondary structure of a protein by other associative forces between the amino acid residues which give three-dimensional conformation is called tertiary structure. In the tertiary structure, proteins fold into compact structure. Okay, the tertiary structure reflects overall shape of the molecule. For example, myoglobin, the polypeptide chains are folded in such a way that hydrophobic side chains are buried inside and its polar side chains are on the surface or to the exterior condition. Here, in tertiary structure, forces involved are hydrogen bonds, hydrophobic interactions, van der Waals forces, and disulfide bonds. Okay, that is about the tertiary structure of the proteins. Now, let us go through here quaternary structure of a protein. So, question will be asked like this. What are the salient features of quaternary structure of a protein? The association of catalytically or functionally active small subunits of the protein is called quaternary structure. The quaternary structure of protein is due to proteins having more than one polypeptide chain. And if they have more than one polypeptide chain, we can use the terminology subunits. We have four subunits. We have two subunits like that. Okay. Example, hemoglobin, where you could see the presence of four polypeptide chains, that is two alpha and two beta chains can be seen. So four subunits will be there. Lactate dehydrogenase, in short LDH, you can see the presence of four polypeptide chains. Creatinine kinase, in short CK, two polypeptide chains can be seen over there. Okay, and here these quaternary structures of protein are forces involved for stabilization are hydrophobic interaction, hydrogen bonds, and ionic bonds. Now let us go through here another question. What are the biologically important peptides, okay, and what are their important functions? Okay, here we are not dealing with the proteins, here we are dealing with the peptides. Okay, so we cannot call the only macromolecules will become the protein molecules, whereas these peptides are which do not come under the macromolecules protein category. So let us go through some of the peptides. Glutathione, in short GSH, there you can see the presence of three amino acids. Okay, this glutathione takes part in the reduction reactions and in the detoxification of hydrogen peroxide, which maintains the integrity of RBC membrane. Okay, then thyrotropin releasing hormones, in short TRH, you can see the presence of three amino acids. Okay, it is produced in the hypothalamus. Important functions: release TSH from the anterior pituitary gland, then angiotensin second, where you could see the presence of only eight amino acids. Okay, eight amino acids formed from the angiotensin first by the action of converting enzyme. Important functions that stimulates the aldosterone secretion from the zona glomerulosa cells of adrenal cortex. It means they are powerful vasoconstrictor, okay, which increases the BP. Vasopressin, that is ADH, where you could see the presence of nine amino acids secreted by the posterior pituitary gland, causes absorption of water from the renal tubules. Next, the last one, angiotensins first, that is decaptive, that is decapeptide,
this decapeptide, there you can see the presence of 10 amino acids, only 10 amino acids. When there are 10 amino acids, we cannot say that as the polypeptide. So we are going to mention that as the decapeptides. These decapeptides formed by the action of renin on angiotensinogen, that is alpha globulin. Okay, important functions. It is converted to angiotensin second by the C, which increases the BP or hypertension. Okay, next question, what are simple proteins? Simple proteins consist of only simple amino acids. These are albumins, for example, egg white, which is soluble in water, precipitated by full saturation with ammonium sulfate. Globulins, soluble in dilute neutral salt solution, egg yolk and myosin of muscle. Okay, it is precipitated by half saturation with ammonium sulfate. Glutenins, that is soluble in dilute acids and alkalis. Example, glutenin of wheat and rosin of rice. Then prolamins are alcohol soluble proteins. Example, rosin of corn and glycine of wheat. Histones are basic proteins. Okay, globulin of hemoglobin and nucleohistone. Protamines are basic proteins and present in nucleoproteins of sperm, that is nucleoprotamines. So this is about the simple proteins. I've explained in detail about the simple proteins in the proteins video. You can go through that also. Okay, now let us go through what are conjugated proteins. Give examples. Answer, conjugated proteins contain amino acids and non-protein prosthetic group. Example, chromoproteins, nucleoproteins, glycoproteins, phosphoproteins and lipoproteins. As the name suggests, there chromoproteins, chromo means color, which contains the pigment. For example, hemoglobin, heme, which is the red pigment, which is conjugated with the globulin or with the protein molecules. These particular colored pigment are conjugated. Nucleoproteins, nucleic acids are conjugated with protein molecules. Glycoprotein, carbohydrates, which act like conjugated protein or prosthetic group. Prosthetic group is non-protein part. Okay, then phosphoproteins, phosphoric acid plus protein, which is the phosphoprotein. Example, casein of milk. Phosphoric acid is the conjugated proteins and our prosthetic group. Okay, then lipoproteins, that is lipids plus proteins. Example, chylomicrons, that is VLDL, ILDL, etc. Now coming to what are derived proteins, give examples. See, whatever I told here in the previous slide, simple proteins, then conjugated proteins, then derived proteins. So in the exam, they may also ask you a question, define proteins and give the classification of proteins based on their chemical composition. So chemical composition, you can classify that as simple proteins, then conjugated proteins, okay, then derived proteins. Now let us go through what are derived proteins. Derived proteins are formed by treatment with heat, acids, and by the hydrolysis of native proteins. Or also you can say derived proteins are the derivatives of simple and conjugated proteins. For example, primary derived proteins, that is denatured proteins and meta proteins. Secondary derived proteins are formed by progressive hydrolysis of proteins. Okay, that is proteases, peptones and peptides are the which comes under derived proteins. What is electrophoresis and what are the important applications of electrophoresis? Okay, what do you mean electrophoresis? Movement of charged particle in the electric field either towards cathode or anode when subjected to an electric current is called electrophoresis. In short, you can also say migration of charged particles are biomolecules under the influence of electric field known as electrophoresis. The following factors influence the movement of particles during the electrophoresis. So what are those? Electric current, net charge of the particle, size and shape of the particle, type of supporting media, then buffer solution. So all these factors play a very important role during the electrophoresis methodology. Okay, now let us go to important applications of electrophoresis. electrophoresis. The technique of electrophoresis is used to separate and identify the serum proteins, serum lipoproteins, and blood hemoglobins. See, I'm going to cover here this electrophoresis by keeping in mind about the proteins perception. Okay, when you go for the separation technique through electrophoresis, we have even the blotting techniques also, right? We have separation techniques of the biomolecules, that is separation of DNA molecule, separation of RNA molecule, and also separation of the specifically protein molecule. So separation of DNA molecule known as southern blotting, and separation of RNA molecule known as northern blotting, then proteins known as western blotting. That you'll understand concept in the genetic engineering or rDNA technology. Now let us go to the next question. What are the different types of electrophoresis? Okay, moving boundary electrophoresis. This technique was first introduced by Tiselius in the year 1937. Then zone electrophoresis. In this type of electrophoresis, different types of supporting media are used. Okay, and our paper electrophoresis, that is by using Wachtmann filter paper, cellulose acetate. And the second one is gel electrophoresis, where we'll be using the source of agarose or polyacrylamide gel, which are used for the separation of isoenzymes or proteins. Then SDS page. Full form of SDS page, sodium dodecyl sulfate polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Then isoelectric focusing, okay, that is protein separated in a medium possessing a stable pH gradient. And next one is immunoelectrophoresis. This is for the separation of immunoglobulins. Okay, these are the, some of the different types of electrophoresis. But most of the time, we'll refer only the few electrophoresis. Now let us go through what is chromatography and what are the important applications of chromatography. Answer: chromatography is a special technique by means of which a group of similar substances are separated by a continuous redistribution between two phases. Okay, what are those two phases? One is stationary phase, other one is the moving phase. Okay, these two phases are very important. Many variety of attractive forces act between the stationary phase and the substances to be separated, resulting in the separation of molecules. Important applications of chromatography. This special technique is used for the separation and identification of sugars, that is for the diagnosis of inborn errors of carbohydrate metabolism, amino acids, for the diagnosis of inborn errors of amino acid metabolism, for example phenylketonuria, okay, that is PKU. The lipid functions, so lipid fractions, mainly for the separation of phospholipids to find out lecithin, okay, sphingomyelin ratio in the hyaline membrane disease, that is RDS. Now let us go through one of the most important question with the answer, that is what are the different types of chromatography. There are various types of chromatography, in which the first one is paper chromatography, then thin layer chromatography, GLC, gas liquid chromatography, ion exchange chromatography, then high performance liquid chromatography. Paper chromatography, here you'll be using stationary phase and mobile phase. Stationary phase is Wachtmann filter paper and mobile phase is a solvent system. For example, butanol, acetic acid and water will be using, okay, in solvent medium. And this paper chromatography used for the separation of amino acids. Then thin layer chromatography. Here in thin layer chromatography, you'll be using stationary phase as glass plates coated with silica gel, okay, and solvent system as mobile phase. TLC is used for the separation of phospholipids and amino acids. Then gas liquid chromatography, in short GLC, a separation technique in which the mobile phase is a gas. Okay, GLC is used for the separation of volatile substances like fatty acids. Then comes ion exchange chromatography. In this technique, separation is based in differences in the ion exchange affinities of the sample components. High performance liquid chromatography, in short HPLC, a type of liquid chromatography that uses an efficient column containing small particles of stationary phase. HPLC is carried out under liquid pressure in the chromatographic matrix. This improves speed and resolution for the efficient separation of substances. So this is all about the different types of chromatography. Now let us go through what are the main steps of paper chromatography in the separation of amino acids. The chromatographic chamber is saturated with solvent system, that is with the butanol, acetic acid and water. Okay, the solvent system is kept on the upper portion of the chamber in the glass through glass trough. Okay, glass, in the glass trough we are going to keep descending. We have, when you recall the paper chromatography, we have the descending paper chromatography and also ascending paper chromatography. A drop of the sample containing unknown amino acid is applied about 5 cm from the end of the Waksman filter paper. Known standard amino acids are also applied on the line of the point of application. Okay, the filter paper slip is dipped in the solvent system and is hung above downwards. As the solvent moves from above downwards by the capillary action, okay, the amino acids also depending upon their RF values will move. Once the solvent reaches the other end, the paper is removed from the chamber and is dried and sprayed with ninhydrine, okay, ninhydrine and acetone, and heated very gently. Okay, purple spots of amino acids will be developed. Heated gently means just you are going to provide a warm heat. Amino acids will be identified by calculating RF values. Amino acids with large nonpolar groups move with the faster rate. Okay, fastest rate. Then phenin, alanine, isoleucine and leucine can be seen over there. The amino acids with polar groups are least mobile amino acids. Then what is RF value? What is the importance of RF value? RF value is the relative fraction value. This is calculated by the formula. RF value is equal to distance traveled by the substances, that is amino acid, the distance travel by the solvent front. By RF value, the unknown amino acids present in a sample can be identified. For instance, the RF value of unknown spot is X and RF value of leucine is also same. The unknown spot is identified as leucine because its RF value corresponds to the RF value of leucine standard. Now the last question, which is the simplest amino acid, which amino acid lacks the asymmetric C carbon atom, asymmetric C atom, okay, carbon atom? Answer, glycine. Hope you understood this today's question answers related to proteins and chromatography. I, Dr. Pratibha K, signing off for today. Stay tuned with me. I'll be back with some more videos. And kindly subscribe my channel to get notifications of my videos. Thank you.